Sci-fi culture, sci-fi culture, I hear you saying. Who on earth is this Harry Bates guy? The editor of Astounding Science Fiction was John Campbell, who defined the golden age of science fiction. Why aren't you talking about him? It was Campbell who influenced science fiction more than any man. Campbell who mentored Asimov and other brilliant writers. Campbell who this series should begin with. You haven't even been able to find a photo of Harry Bates for this video. That's how insignificant he is. Patience, my friends. We will get to Campbell, God willing, in time. But Campbell, though he was the most influential figure of the golden age of science fiction, was not the creator or first editor of Astounding Science Fiction. That honour belongs to Harry Bates. But even so, I suspect many of you will feel that I should start with Campbell. After all, it was only under Campbell that the Astounding Science Fiction became the genre-defining magazine it is remembered as. But to understand the golden age of Astounding Science Fiction, you have to understand the place where it came from. And that place was the world of the pulps. The world of magazines, costing 15 to 25 cents each, printed on the cheapest possible paper, with brightly coloured covers and filled with sensational stories of every kind. These publications sold in the millions during the first half of the 20th century, and for many, especially amongst those with lower incomes, were one of their chief sources of entertainment. This was the world that birthed Astounding, the world that Harry Bates belonged to, and so it is with Harry Bates that we must begin. Astounding was conceived in the year 1929, the last year of the Roaring Twenties, by William Clayton and Harry Bates. Clayton was a publisher. He published popular pulp magazines. Clayton had a lot of magazines. They included productions such as Ace High, a magazine devoted to westerns, Clues, which is full of detective stories, Cowboy Stories, which is also about westerns, Danger Trail, which tells exciting adventure stories about exotic locales and is probably only moderately racist by modern standards, Ranch Romances, which is also about westerns but with romances and aimed at women, Rangeland Love, which seems to be exactly the same thing as Ranch Romances, and Five Novels Monthly, which, as the name suggests, published five, presumably rather short, novels each issue. So what I'm saying is that there were a lot of westerns. There were also others, apparently 13 in total, but I haven't been able to identify the rest. But Clayton was not content. You see, he didn't have enough magazines. Clayton printed covers for his magazines on a single sheet on a 4x4 grid. But this means that there were three empty spaces on each cover sheet. What lamentable lack of efficiency. If only he had 16 magazines instead of 13, then each cover sheet would be entirely filled and profits would flow like rain. So Clayton called in one of his editors, Harry Bates, with a suggestion. He wanted Bates to start a new magazine, and he suggested that it would be called Torchlights of History, and would be devoted to period pieces, what we would today call historical fiction. Bates was horrified. He protested that it would be impossibly difficult to find pulp writers capable of writing period pieces. Historical fiction requires a good knowledge of history, and pulp writers were not typically enormously educated. But Clayton wasn't deterred. He wanted a new magazine, so Bates would have to create Torchlight. Then an idea came to Bates. While perusing the stands, he had come across a publication called Amazing Stories, a science fiction magazine, although the word science fiction is not in universal circulation at that point. He doesn't think much of it, declaring it cluttered with trivial, packed with puerilities, written by unimaginables. But it had to be easier than historical fiction. So he makes a counter-proposal. Rather than Torchlight, how about a science fiction magazine? Clayton agreed, and so the magazine Astounding Stories of Super Science was born. This, at least, is the story Harry Bates will tell over 30 years later. Others tell other tales, But regardless of how it began, Clayton won't reap the profits. Astounding was conceived in the very last days of 20s prosperity. By the time its first issues are published, the Great Depression will already be in full swing. Now, pulp entertainment will actually do better in this environment than many other businesses. Just witness the rise of Golden Age comics. But Clayton had chosen this very moment to buy out his partner in business, and so was deeply in debt. By 1933, about 3 years after the initial issue of Astounding, Clayton Publishing was forced to close shop and sell off its assets. But the history of Astounding would not end there. It would continue across the Great Depression and World War II, and move into the opening days of the Cold War as the most influential science fiction magazine in history. In the very first issue of Astounding, Harry Bates published a sort of mission statement for the magazine. I think I will read it. Not because it gives an actual description of the sort of thing that Astounding would do in these early years, but precisely because, for the most part, it doesn't. Astounding Stories. What are Astounding Stories? Well, if you lived in Europe in 1490 and someone told you the Earth was round and moved around the sun, that would have been an astounding story. Or if you lived in 1840 and were told that someday men 1,000 miles apart would be able to talk with each other through a little wire or without any wire at all, that would have been another. Or if in 1900 they predicted ocean crossing airplanes and submarines, world girding zeppelins, 60 story buildings, radio, metal that can be made to resist gravity and float in the air. These would have been other astounding stories. Today, time has gone by and all these things are commonplace. That is the only real difference between the astounding and commonplace. Time. Tomorrow, more astounding things are going to happen. Your children, or their children, are going to take a trip to the moon. They will be able to render themselves invisible, a problem that has already been partly solved. They will be able to disintegrate their bodies in New York and reintegrate them in China, and in a matter of seconds. Astounding? Yes. Impossible? Well, television would have been impossible, almost unthinkable, 10 years ago. Now you will see the kind of magazine that it is our pleasure to offer you, beginning with this, the first number of Astounding Stories. It is a magazine whose stories will anticipate the super scientific achievements of tomorrow, whose stories will not only be strictly accurate in their science, but will be vividly, dramatically, and thrillingly told. Already we have secured stories by some of the finest writers of fantasy in the world. Men such as Ray Cummings, Murray Leinster, Captain S.P. Peake, Hall Vincent, R.F. Stiles, and Victor Rossio. So order your next month's copy of Astounding Stories in advance. The Editor. There are several things to note about this declaration. The first is that the complete lack of historical accuracy it portrays concerns that Harry Bates was wise indeed to reject the notion of editing a magazine of historical fiction. No, Bates, people did not think the world was round in 1490, and I very much doubt they would be hugely astonished in 1900 by the things you mention, considering that most of them already existed. The second, however, is more to the point. From the very beginning, Astounding Stories presented itself as more than just a bulk of pulp action stories. Rather, these would be stories with a grounding in scientific reality. Needless to say, they weren't. Well, for the most part, they weren't. As Harry Page said years later, when recounting his tenure as an editor, I've somewhat abbreviated it for space. To state it bluntly, the science fiction of the early writers had little relation to the science of the scientists. However, it has as much relation as it has had since, in the main. The extrapolation of most science fiction writers rockets starward from pads much too narrow and rickety. If the writers were solidly grounded in the sciences, and if they were aware of the intermeshings of the sciences, and if each one had a stiff conscience, there'd be very little science fiction written. Literally, most writers would not be able to finish a story from guilty awareness of the piling up of related things that were scientifically incompatible. However, it happens that each member of the species has a permissive conscience. The naked fact is, almost all of what is called science fiction is fantasy, and nothing else but. This has increasingly come to be recognised, but when I began privately saying so, near the beginning, I would get arguments. Do you aging buffs really think there is more science in science fiction nowadays? Do you really think the stories are less impossible? Of course they are better written, many of them, and more thought-provoking, some of them. But science? Hurrah for our honest old super science! In declaring that this is true of all science fiction, I think Bates goes a bit far. But there is no doubt that it is true of the science fiction that Bates edited. Because Bates, and it is important to understand this in order to understand his era of Astounding, was not an editor of science fiction. Bates was an editor of pulp. Hugo Gernsback, the first publisher of a science fiction magazine, might have seen science fiction as a way to educate the masses or inspire inventors, but to Bates, it was simply a way to deliver fun stories. As for the science or ideas of the genre, he frankly couldn't care less. And whilst later in life he would try his hand at writing some science fiction, most notably Farewell to the Master, which would be adapted into The Day the Earth Stood Still, it was the experience of editing Astounding that moved him into the world of science fiction. He had not the slightest real interest in it when he began, and yet he would be Astounding's shepherd through its infancy. So let's take a journey through the first age of Astounding. This is the story of Astounding Stories of Super Science. It's a magazine born of capitalism and containing all the fun of a pulp. It's the first almost forgotten incarnation of Astounding Science Fiction, and in the next few weeks we will be looking at its earliest stories. I hope you'll be there.